Hi friends, welcome to our e-teaching channel. I'm back with the most fascinating and captivating stories of immortals of Meluha. We are in chapter 7 today. As usual, we'll have a short recap of what happened in chapter 6 was about Vikarma, the carriers of bad fate. And we saw Sati was a Vikarma lady. And in the end of the chapter 6, we saw that Shiva touched Sati, and instantly everyone said that Shiva should have a Shuddhikaran. So Shiva is confused what's wrong with everyone, why he needs a Shuddhikaran. So our chapter end with that confusion of Shiva. Okay, let's now move forward to chapter 7. Chapter 7 is Lord Ram's unfinished task.
You seem to be a little distracted this morning, my lord. Are you all right? Asked your concerned Daksha.
Said Shiva as he looked up. I'm sorry, your highness. I was a little distracted.
Daksha looked with a concerned expression at Kanakala. He had seen a similar look of despair on Sati's face at Jinnar the previous night, but she had refused to say anything.
Do you want to meet later? Asked Daksha.
Of course not, your highness. It's all right. My apologies.
Please continue, said Shiva.
Well, continued a concerned Daksha.
We were talking about the changes that Lord Ram brought about in society.
Yes, said Shiva, shaking his head slightly to get the disturbing image of Sati's last plea out of his mind.
The Mica system worked fantastically well. Our society boomed. Ours was always one of the wealthiest lands on earth. But in the last 1,200 years, we have shot dramatically ahead of everyone else. Meluha has become the richest and the most powerful country in the world by far. Our citizens lead ideal lives. There is no crime. People do what they are suited for and not what an unfair social order would compel them to do. We don't force or fight unprovoked wars with any other country. In fact, ours has become a perfect society.
Yes, your highness, agreed Shiva, slowly getting into the conversation.
I don't believe that perfection can ever be achieved. It is more of a journey than a destination. But your society is certainly a near perfect society.
Why do you think we are not perfect? Argued Parvateshwar aggressively.
Do you think it is perfect, Parvateshwar? Asked Shiva politely.
Does everything in Meluha go exactly as Lord Ram would have mandated?
Parvateshwar fell silent. He knew the obvious, even if he did not like the answer.
The Lord is right, Parvateshwar, said Daksha. There are always things to improve.
Having said that, your highness, spoke Shiva, your society is wonderful. Things do seem very well ordered. What does not make sense to me then is why you and your people are so concerned about the future. What is the problem? Why is a Nilkanth required?
I don't see anything that is so obviously wrong. The disaster would be just a breath away. This is not like my homeland, where there are so many problems that you would not know where to begin.
My lord, a Nilkanth is needed because we are faced with challenges that we cannot confront. We keep to ourselves and let other countries lead their lives. We trade with other societies, but we never interfere with them. We don't allow uninvited foreigners into Meluha beyond the frontier towns. So, we think it's only fair that other societies leave us alone to lead our lives the way we want to, and presumably they don't, your highness.
No, they don't. Why? One simple word, my lord, replied Daksha. Jealousy. They hate our superior race. Our efficient family system is an eyesore to them. The fact that we take care of everyone in our country makes them unhappy because they can't take care of themselves. They lead sorry lives, and rather than improving themselves, they want to pull us down to their level. I can understand. My tribe used to face a lot of jealousy in Mount Kailash since we had control over the shore of the Manasarovar Lake and hence the best land in the region. But sometimes I wonder if we could have avoided bloodshed if we had shared our good fortune more willingly. But we do share our good fortune with those who wish it, my lord. And yet jealousy blinds our enemies. The Chandravanshis realized that it was the Somryas that guaranteed our superiority. Funnily enough, even they have the knowledge of the Somryas, but they have not learned to mass produce it like we do, and hence have not reaped all the benefits of it. Sorry to interrupt, Your Highness, but where is the Somryas produced? It is produced at a secret location called Mount Mandar. The Somryas powder is manufactured there and then distributed throughout the empire at the designated temples across Meliuha. Trained Brahmins mix it with water and other ingredients to administer it to the population. All right, said Shiva. The Chandravanshis could not become as powerful as us since they never had enough Somryas. Eaten up by their jealousy, they devised a devious way to destroy the Somryas and hence us. One of the key ingredients in the Somryas is the waters of the Saraswati. Water from any other source does not work. Really? Why? We don't know, my lord. The scientist can't explain it, but only the waters of the Saraswati will do. That is why the Chandravanshis tried to kill the Saraswati to harm us. Kill the river? Asked Shiva incredulously. Yes, my lord, said Daksha, as his childlike eyes flared up at the Chandravanshi perfidly. The Saraswati comes from the confluence of two mighty rivers up north, the Satluj and the Yamuna. In the olden days, the course of the Satluj and Yamuna used to be neutral territory. Both the Chandravanshis and we visited the land to draw waters for the Somryas. But how did they try to kill the Saraswati, Your Highness? They diverted the course of the Yamuna so that instead of flowing south, it started flowing east to meet their main river, Ganga. You can do that? Asked Shiva in amazement. Change the course of a river? Yes, of course, you can, answered Parvateshwar. We were livid, interjected Daksha, but we still gave them a chance to make amends for their duplicity. And what can you expect from the Chandravanshis, my lord? Said Daksha in disgust. They denied any knowledge of this. They claimed that the river made such a dramatic change in its course all by itself due to some minor earthquake. And even worse, they claimed that since the river had changed course of its own accord, we Meliuhans would simply have to accept what was essentially God's will. We of course refused to do that, said Parvateshwar. Under the leadership of King Brahmanayak, His Highness, Father, we attacked Swadweep, the land of the Chandravanshis, asked Shiva. Yes, Shiva, said Parvateshwar. And it was a resounding victory. The Chandravanshis' army was routed. King Brahmanayak kindly let them keep their lands and even their system of governance. We did not even ask for any war reparations or yearly tribute either. The only term of surrender treaty was the return of the Yamuna. We restored the Yamuna to her original course to meet with the Saraswati. You fought in that war, Parvateshwar? Yes, said Parvateshwar, his chest swollen with pride. I was a mere soldier then. but I did fight in that war. Turning to Daksha, Shiva asked, then what is the problem now, your highness? Your enemy was comprehensively defeated. Then why is Saraswati still dying? We believe that the Chandravanshis are up to something again. We don't understand it as yet. After their defeat, the area between our two countries was made into a no man's land, and the jungle has reclaimed it. That included the early course of the Yamuna as well. We stuck to our part of the bargain and never disturbed that region. It appears that they did not honor their end of the promise. Are you sure of that, your highness? Has the area been checked? Has this been discussed with the Chandravanshis representative in your empire? Are you trying to say that we are lying? Countered Parvateshwar. True Suryavanshis don't lie. Parvateshwar scolded Daksha angrily. The Lord was not implying anything like that. Listen to me, Parvateshwar, said Shiva politely. If I have learned something from the pointless battles of my land, it is that wars should be the last resort. If there is another solution possible, there is no harm in saving some young soldier's life. A mother somewhere would bless us for it. Let's not fight. Wonderful. What a great savior we have, Parvateshwar muttered under his breath. You have something to say, Parvateshwar, barked Kanakala. I have told you before. You will not insult the Nilkanth in my presence. I don't take orders from you, growled Parvateshwar. Enough, ordered Daksha. Turning to Shiva, he continued, I'm sorry, my lord, you are right. We should not just declare war without being sure. That is why I have avoided a war till now. But look at the facts of the case. The flow of Saraswati has been slowly depleting for the last 50 years. And the last few years have been horrible, said Kanakala, as she controlled her tears at the slow death of the river most Malayans regarded as a mother. The Saraswati does not even reach the sea now and ends in an inland delta just south of Rajasthan, and the Somras cannot be made without water from the Saraswati, continued Daksha. The Chandravanshis know that, and that is why they are trying to kill her. What does the Swadeep representative say about it? Has he been questioned? We have no diplomatic relations with Swadeep, my lord, said Daksha. Really? I thought having representatives of other countries was one of your innovative systems. It gives you an opportunity to better understand them and maybe avoid jumping into a war. I had heard of a diplomatic mission from Mesopotamia coming in 2 days ago. Then why not have this with Swadeep as well? You don't know them, my lord. They are untrustworthy people. No follower of the Suryavanshi way will dirty his soul by even speaking to a Chandravanshi willingly. Shiva frowned but did not say anything. You don't know the levels they have sunk to, my lord. Over the previous few years, they have even started using the cursed Nagas in their terrorist attacks on us, said Kanakala with a disgusted look. Terrorist attacks? Yes, my lord, said Daksha. Their defeat kept them quiet for many decades, and because of our overwhelming victory in the previous war, they believe that they cannot overpower us in an open confrontation. So they have resorted to a form of assault that only repulsive people like them could turn to. Terrorist attacks. I didn't understand. What exactly do they do? They send small bands of assassins who launch surprise attacks on non-military but public places. Their idea is to attack non-combatants, the Brahmins, Vaishyas or Shudras. They try to devastate places like temples, public baths, areas where there may not be soldiers to fight back, but whose destruction will wreck the empire's morale and spread terror. That's disgusting. Even the Prakritis in my land, a bunch of complete barbarians, would not do that, said Shiva. Yes, said Parvateshwar. These Chandravanshis don't fight like men. They fight like cowards. Then why don't you attack their country? Finish this once and for all. We would like to, my lord, said Daksha. But I am not sure we can defeat them, Shiva observed Parvateshwar, seething silently at the insult to his army, before turning towards Daksha. Why, your highness, you have a well-trained and efficient force. I am sure your army can defeat them. Two reasons, my lord. Firstly, we are outnumbered. We were outnumbered even 100 years back, but not by a very significant margin. But today, we estimate that they have a population of more than 80 million compared to our 8 million. They can throw a much larger army at us. Their sheer numbers will cancel out our technological superiority. But why should your population be less? You have people who live beyond the age of 200 years. Your population should be higher. Sociological causes, my lord, said Daksha. Our country is rich. Children are a matter of choice more than a duty. Parents would adopt children from the Maika system in small numbers, maybe one or two, so that they could devote more attention on their upbringing. Fewer and fewer mothers are giving birth at Maika as well. In Swadeep, for the poor, children are bonded labor to supplement a family's income. The more children they have, the less poor the family. So that country as a whole has a far larger population. And the second reason for avoiding war? The second reason is something that is under our control. We fight with rules of war, with norms and ethics. The Chandravanshis do nothing like that. And I feel that this is a weakness in us that our ruthless enemies can exploit. Rules of war? Asked Shiva. Yes. For example, we will not attack an unarmed man. A superior armed person, like a cavalryman, will not attack an inferior armed person, like a spear-wielding foot soldier. A sportsman will never attack a person below his waist, because that is unethical. The Chandravanshis don't care for such niceties. They will attack whomsoever and however they find expedient to ensure victory. Begging your pardon, your highness, said Parvateshwar, but that difference is what makes us who we are. Like Rod Ram said, a person's ethics and character are not tested in good times. It is only in bad times that a person shows how steadfast he is to his dharma. But Parvateshwar, sighed Daksha, we are not under attack by people who are as ethical and decent as us. Our way of life is under assault. If we don't fight back in any which way we can, we will lose. My apologies once again, your highness, said Parvateshwar. I have never said that we should not fight back. I am eager to attack. I have been asking repeatedly for permission to declare war on the Chandravanshis. But if we fight without our rules, our codes, our ethics, then our way of life is as good as destroyed. And the Chandravanshis would have won without even fighting us. At the ringing of the Prahar town bell, the conversation was halted as everyone said a quick prayer. Shiva turned towards the window, wondering if Sati would be dancing today. Daksha turned to Shiva expectantly. Do you need to leave, my lord? No, your highness, said Shiva, hiding the pain and confusion he felt inside. I don't believe I am expected anywhere at this point of time. At this, the smile on Daksha's face disappeared with his hopes. Shiva continued, "If it is all right with you, Your Highness, may we continue our conversation? Perhaps we can have our lunch little later." "Of course we may, my lord," smiled Daksha, pulling himself together. "I have got the story so far, Your Highness. While I can understand your reasons for not wanting to attack right now, you clearly have a plan in which my blue throat has some strange role to play." "Yes, we do have a plan, my lord. I feel that as an emperor, my giving in unthinkingly to the righteous anger of some of our people will not solve our problem. I believe that the people of Swadeep themselves are not evil. It is the Chandravanshi rulers and their way of life that has made them evil. The only way forward for us is to save the Swadeepians themselves." Save the Swadeepians? Asked Shiva, genuinely surprised. "Yes, my lord. Save them from the evil philosophy that infects their soul. Save them from their treacherous rulers. Save them from their sorry, meaningless existence. And we can do this by giving them the benefits of the superior Suryavanshi way of life. Once they become like us, there will be no reason to fight. We will live like brothers. This is the unfinished task of my father, King Brahmanayak. In fact, it is the unfinished task of Lord Ram." "That is a big task to take on, Your Highness," said Shiva. "It is sweeping in its kindness and reason, but it is a very big task. You will need soldiers to defeat their army and missionaries to bring them to your side. It is not going to be easy. I agree. There are many in my empire who have concerns about even attacking Swadeep, and I am putting forth a much bigger challenge to them of reforming Swadeep. That is why I did not want to launch this without the Nilakanth, my lord." Shiva remembered his uncle's words spoken many years back in what was almost another life. "Your destiny lies beyond the mountains. Whether you fulfill it or run away once again is up to you." As Daksha spoke once again, Shiva refocused his attention on him. "The problems that we are facing were prophesied, my lord," continued Daksha. "Lord Ram had himself said that any philosophy, no matter how perfect, works only for a finite period. That is a law of nature and cannot be avoided. But what the legends also tell us is that when the problems become insurmountable for ordinary men, the Nilkanth will appear, and that he will destroy the evil Chandravanshis and restore the forces of good. My lord, you are the Nilkanth. You can save us. You can complete the unfinished task of Lord Ram. You must lead us and help us defeat the Chandravanshis. You must rally the Swadeepians around to the side of good. Otherwise, I fear that this beautiful country that we have, the near-perfect society of Melyuha, will be destroyed in years of endless war. Will you help us, my lord? Will you lead us?" Shiva was confused. "But I didn't understand, Your Highness. What exactly would I do?" "I don't know, my lord. We only know our destination and that you will be our leader. The path we take is up to you. They want me to destroy the entire way of life of 80 million people by myself. Are they mad?" Shiva spoke carefully. "I empathize with your people and their hardships, Your Highness. But to be quite honest, I don't really understand how one man like me can make a difference." "If that man is you, my lord," said Daksha, his moist eyes opened wide in devotion and faith, "he can change the entire universe." "I'm not so sure of that, Your Highness," said Shiva with a weak smile. Why will my being present make such a difference? I am no miracle worker. I cannot snap my fingers and cause bolts of lightning to descend on the Chandravanshis. It is your presence itself that will make the difference, my lord. I invite you to travel through the empire. See the effect your blue throat has on the people. Once my people believe that they can do it, they will be able to do it. You are the Neelakanth, my lord, added Kanakala. The people have faith in the bearer of the blue throat. They will have faith in you. Will you help us, my lord? Will you run away once again? But how do you know that my blue throat makes me the genuine Neelakanth? Asked Shiva. For all you know, there may be many Meluhans with a blue throat waiting to be discovered. No, my lord, said Daksha. It cannot be a Meluhan. The legend says that the Neelakanth will be a foreigner. He cannot be from the Saptasindhu, and that he will get a blue throat on drinking the Somras. Shiva did not answer. He looked stunned as truth suddenly dawned upon him. Srinagar, the first night, Somras. That's how my body got repaired. That's why I'm feeling stronger than ever. Daksha and Kanakala looked at Shiva breathlessly, waiting for his decision, praying for his right decision. But why only me? All the gunas were given the Somras. Was my uncle right? Do I really have a destiny? Parvateshwar stared at Shiva with narrowed eyes. I don't deserve any destiny. But maybe this is my chance to redeem myself. But first, Shiva asked with controlled politeness, Your Highness, before I answer, may I ask you a question? Of course, my lord. Do you agree that honesty is required to make any friendship work? Even if it means deeply offending your friend with the truth? Yes, of course, replied Daksha, wondering where Shiva was going with this. Complete honesty is not just the bedrock of an individual relationship, but of any stable society, interjected Parvateshwar. I could not agree more, said Shiva, and yet Meluha was not honest with me. Nobody said anything, Shiva continued in a courteous but firm tone. When my tribe was being invited to come to Meluha, we had the impression you wanted immigrants because you needed people to work, and I was happy to escape my benighted land. But now I realize that you were systematically searching for the Neelakanth. Turning to Nandi, Shiva said, We were not told that a medicine called the Somras would be administered to us as soon as we entered. We were not told that the medicine would have such effects. Nandi looked down with guilty eyes. His lord had the right to be angry with him. Turning to Daksha, Shiva continued, Your Highness, you know that the Somras was probably administered to me on my first night in Kashmir without my knowledge. I'm truly sorry about that dishonesty, my lord, said Daksha with his hands in a penitent namaste. It's something that I will always be ashamed of, but the stakes were too high for us, and the Somras has considerably positive effects on your body. It does not harm you in any way. I know I'm not exactly upset about having to live a long and healthy life, said Shiva wryly. Do you know that my tribe was also probably given the Somras that night, and they fell seriously ill, perhaps because of the Somras? They were under no risk, my lord, said Kanakala apologetically. Some people are predisposed towards certain diseases. When the Somras enters the body, it triggers the immediate occurrence of these diseases, which when cured never recur. Hence, the body remains healthy till death. Your tribe is actually much healthier now. No doubt they are, said Shiva. The point is not about the effects of Somras. Both my tribe and I are better for it. Yet, from what I understand of Melyuha, getting somebody to do something without telling him all the facts would not have been Lord Ram's way. You should have told us the complete truth at Mount Kailash. Then you should have let us make an informed choice rather than you making a choice for us. We probably would still have come to Melyuha anyway, but then it would have been our choice. Please forgive us the deception, my lord, said Daksha with guilty regret. It is not our way to do something like this. We pride ourselves on our honesty, but we had no choice. We are truly sorry, my lord. Your people are well taken care of. They are healthier than ever. They will live long, productive lives. Parvateshwar finally broke his silence, speaking what was always in his heart since then search had begun many decades ago. Shiva, we are truly sorry for what has been done. You have every right to be angry. Lying is not our way. I think what was done is appalling, and Lord Ram would have never condoned this. No matter how serious our troubles, we have no right to deceive someone into helping us. I'm deeply sorry. Shiva raised his eyebrow a bit. Parvateshwar is the only one apologizing instead of making excuses. He is a true follower of the great king Ram's way. Shiva smiled. Daksha let out an audible sigh of relief. Shiva turned towards Daksha. Let us put this in the past, Your Highness. Like I said, there are some things about your nation that could be improved. No doubt about that, but it is amongst the best societies that I have seen, and it is worth fighting for. But I have a few conditions. Of course, my lord, said Daksha, eager to please. At this point of time, I am not saying that I can perform the tasks that you expect of me, nor am I saying that I cannot do it. All I am saying is that I will try my best, but before that, I want to understand more of your society before I can be sure of how I can help. I am assuming that nothing will be hidden from me, nor will I be misled. Of course, my lord. Secondly, you still need immigrants to expand your population, but you should not mislead them. I think that you should tell them the entire truth about Melyuha and let them make an informed decision on whether to come here, or you don't invite them at all. Is that fair? Of course it is, my lord, said Daksha. Nodding briefly towards Kanakala, he committed. We will implement that immediately. Furthermore, it is clear to me that I am not going back to Kashmir. Can my tribe, the Grinyas, be brought to Devgiri? I would like them to be with me. Of course, my lord, said Daksha, with a quick look at Kanakala. Instructions will be sent today itself to bring them to Devgiri. Also, I would like to visit the location where you manufacture the Somras. I would like to understand this drink of the gods. Something tells me that it is important to do so. Of course you may, my lord, said Daksha, his face finally breaking into a nervous smile. Kanakala will take you there tomorrow itself. In fact, my family is also scheduled for a visit there day after tomorrow for a puja at the Brahma temple. Perhaps we could meet there. That would be nice, said Shiva, smiling. Then taking a deep breath, he added, and lastly, I guess that you would like to announce the arrival of the Nilkanth to your people. Daksha and Kanakala nodded hesitantly. I would like to request that you don't do that for now. Daksha and Kanakala's face fell immediately. Nandi's eyes were glued to the floor. He had stopped listening to the conversation. The enormity of his prevarication was tearing him apart. Your Highness, I have a terrible feeling that when people know I am the Nilkanth. Every action and word of mine will be over-interpreted and over-analyzed, explained Shiva. I'm afraid that I don't know enough about your society or my task to be able to handle that at this point of time. I understand, my lord, said Daksha, willing a broken smile back on his face. You have my word. Only my immediate staff, my family, and the people you allow will know of the Nilkanth's arrival. Nobody else. Thank you, your highness. But I will say it again. I am a simple tribal man who just happened to get a blue throat because of some exotic medicine. Honestly, I still don't know what one man like me can do in the face of the odds that you face. And I'll say it again, my lord, said Daksha with a childlike smile. If that man is you, he can change the entire universe. Om Namah Shivaya.
Do subscribe to our e-teaching channel for further interesting videos and audio books. Give us a thumbs up if you like our videos and share with your friends and family. Comment us to improve our work better. Thank you.